mad. I am so sorry. I got stuck behind a tractor. Okay, Well, I gotta catch my breath here.
You know, I was thinking about this being an audiobook, and since it's a scholarly work, you know, I thought I ought to bring along a few things. I'm gonna open up my briefcase here. For footnotes, I've got this doorbell, and that way I can indicate exactly when things are a footnote. And then for quotations, I got this clicker here. I'm not going to use it every time somebody talks or something, but for places where you're not sure that it's a quotation, I'll indicate that. So, I think we're ready to go here. Where's the book? Oh, man, I can't believe this. Oh, I left it in the junk. Just a second, I'll be right back. Sorry about that. Okay, we are ready to roll. Here we go. Cue the music. The Definitive Biography of P.D.Q. Bach, 1807 to 1742, ? Copyright 1976 by Peter Schickele. That's me. Library of Congress Cataloging and Publication Data, Schickele, Peter, The Definitive Biography of P.D.Q. Bach. 1, Music, Anecdotes, Facetiae, Satire, etc. 2, Biography, Anecdotes, Facetiae, Satire. Facetiae? They're saying this is a facetious work? Well, I don't like that. Well, the rest of this page is just numbers and stuff. So why don't we go on to the beginning here, okay? Here we go. Part the First, P.D.Q. Bach's Background, Cause or Effect. Chapter 1, Early Infancy, 1742 to 1745. It, i.e. the weather, according to the unique diary kept throughout his entire life by the Margrave Bernhard Erich von Brandenburg, 1738 to 1743, in it he recorded in minute detail each day's weather conditions and nothing else. Was cold and dark and wet in Leipzig on the night of the 31st of March, 1742. The darkness was not unexpected, but the extreme cold was without precedent, and it had been raining incessantly for 3 weeks, as if in preparation for some dire event. In the home of the cantor of St. Thomas Church, however, it was warm and light and dry, due to the large sheaf of Vivaldi manuscripts burning in the fireplace. Johann Sebastian Bach, whenever he came into possession of a manuscript by another composer, used to make his own arrangement of the work and then burn the original, thus cornering the market. Fortunately, his arrangements were better than the original works. Or were they? At 57, Johann Sebastian Bach was at the height of his creative powers, a position he had maintained for over 50 years, ever since he started composing small works for the organ at Lüneburg. Small work number 1 for the organ, Bach's first composition, has been lost. One can imagine him working feverishly on part 4 of his Klavierübung, keyboard übung, with nothing but a few concerti grossi for light, only dimly aware, at the height as he was of his creative powers, that in the adjoining room his second wife was giving birth to his 21st child. Since there was obviously very little novelty in the situation, Bach probably barely looked up when the midwife announced that something has been born. This unfortunate phrase was overheard by the new arrival, and it rankled him for the rest of his life. Upon seeing the child, however, the master's initial indifference gave way to a feeling of benign antipathy, a feeling which remained constant for the 8 years of life that were left to him. At the age of 5, the boy still had not been given a name, and it was only after repeated exhortations by his eldest brother, Wilhelm Friedemann, that his father bestowed upon him not a name, but at least 3 initials, PDQ. When Wilhelm Friedemann asked what the initials stood for, his father said they stood for nothing, which indeed could be said of PDQ himself later in his life. Old Johann Sebastian added something about using up all the available names on his first 20 children, and years later, PDQ Bach wrote to a friend, "In all truthfulness, I can say that to this day I have no idea as to what, if anything, my name represents." In the same letter, he attributed his frequent headaches to the fact that he had been christened in a shipyard rather than in a church. And so it was that on that cold, dark, wet night in Leipzig, at 1 minute after midnight, to be precise, there came into this world one of the most curious figures in the entire history of music in Western civilization. A man who did not change the course of music one iota. A man who defined definitively the doctrine of originality through incompetence. A man who triumphed over the most staggering obstacle ever placed before a composer. Absolute and utter lack of talent. In the years that followed, PDQ Bach steadfastly ignored handicaps that would have sent other men into teaching or government, resulting in a body of works that is without parallel. Historically speaking, that is. Musically, the body of works contains many parallels, especially fifths and octaves. PDQ Bach was the last and by all means the least of Johann Sebastian Bach's 20-odd children, and he was certainly the oddest of the lot. So much so, in fact, that we are tempted to wonder whether old J.S. really was still at the height of his creative powers, until we remember that in the life of an artistic giant, the spirit can function quite distinctly from the flesh. The towering genius that was Bach had already sired a ne'er-do-well, Johann Gottfried Bernhardt, whose principal activity in life was getting into debt and letting his father bail him out, and also an idiot son, Gottfried Heinrich. Wilhelm Friedemann reputedly drank to excess, and according to one source, Christian Gottlieb was mixed up in dealings of dubious legality with members of the underworld. The fact that C.G. died at the age of 3, however, casts a shadow of suspicion on this accusation. Thus we see that PDQ, possessing as he did a combination of many of the traits of previous Bach children, can in a sense be regarded as a summation of Bach the father, just as the art of the fugue is a summation of Bach the composer. In addition to the characteristics mentioned above, PDQ possessed the originality of Johann Christian, the arrogance of Carl Philipp Emanuel, and the obscurity of Johann Christoph Friedrich. PDQ's early infancy ended with a striking decision. At the age of 3, PDQ Bach decided to give up music. Chapter 2, Late Infancy, 1745 to 1766. The decision, as important as it was, went largely unnoticed in the Bach family, due probably to the fact that up until that point the boy had shown no interest in music whatsoever. Another reason it went unnoticed is that PDQ didn't tell anyone about it, since he had not yet learned how to talk. But 40 years later, he still remembered it well, when he wrote to a friend from Wein am Rhein, "Sometimes, when I am sober, I wish that I had held firm to the resolve I made at the age of 3, namely, to give up music for the rest of my life. Whether the feeling of melancholy that descends upon me at those times is due to the lack of a spirit of satisfaction in my life, or simply to the lack of those more easily obtainable spirits, I cannot say. but I have found that applying a remedy to the second of the two possible causes seems to remedy the first as well, with the result that such periods are happily few and far between. Exactly why he made the decision at this time we can only surmise, but the most likely explanation is that it was a gesture of defiance to his father. For the reasons outlined above, it seems improbable that the fateful decision had any effect on Johann Sebastian Bach. Although, 2 years later, he did finally allow the boy to be christened, he also paid his son the ultimate gesture of indifference in 1750 by dying.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.